I woke up early this morning. I was feeling kind of blue. My landlady saw you got a little boy, and I began to sing the blues. It was from my brother. Don't you know the boy's laying down in every night?
As the war in Iraq enters its sixth year, it's becoming increasingly clear it has much in common with the war in Vietnam. With the passing of more than a generation, many Vietnam veterans are questioning America's now familiar and repetitive military policies. Has our failure to fully understand what happened in Vietnam condemned us to repeat it in Iraq, they ask? And for this reason alone, they believe, the reality of the war in Vietnam needs to be re-examined for our own sake, but more importantly, for the sake of future generations.
What makes a Holocaust besides destruction by fire? How many people have to be slaughtered? Is a million enough? How about 2 million destroyed by fire? Would that make a Holocaust?
How many people died in the Vietnam War? We know the number of Americans with some precision. It is just over 58,000, each with his or her name engraved on the Vietnam Memorial Wall in Washington, D.C. But how many Vietnamese, not to mention Laotians or Cambodians, died in the war with the U.S.? And who would know? Probably no one would know for certain. In 1995, Vietnam released a figure of 4 million civilians and 1 million combatants killed. Nobody has officially challenged those figures. However, Robert McNamara, the longest-serving U.S. Secretary of Defense, has established a much lower number. Before the Vietnam War was considered Nixon's war or Johnson's war, it was considered McNamara's war. And before Vietnam, McNamara was considered a bomb damage efficiency expert during World War II and a top advisor to B-29 Bomber Force Commander Curtis LeMay. Did his position in training qualify McNamara to know the true number of Vietnamese killed in the war? The same year the Vietnamese released their tally of 5 million souls, McNamara paid a visit to Vietnam. While he was there, he gave them his numbers.
Do you mean to say it was not a tragedy for you when you lost 3,400,000 Vietnamese killed, which on our population base is the equivalent of 27 million Americans? What did you accomplish?
Since it was their country, their towns and villages, and the lives of their men, women, and children, it is solely for the Vietnamese to determine if their independence is worth the price the U.S. exacted. The Vietnam War was the first so-called television war.
After 5 years of killing, the gears of the Vietnam death machine were grinding more slowly in the months before the invasion of Cambodia.
Almost all restraint is off. For the first time, the Vietnamese are seeing the Holocaust of conventional war, the kind that leveled much of Korea and destroyed dozens of cities in World War II.
The major Western media reported on it from the killing fields.
A truckload of refugees goes up in smoke. Women, children, babies. Some are dead, some are not dead. By evening, government spokesmen are saying another grand victory has been won in Quang Tri province. The situation is once again stabilized. But there will be more fighting and more words. Words spoken by generals, journalists, politicians. But here on Route 1, it's difficult to imagine what those words can be. There's nothing left to say about this war. There's just nothing left to say. Bob Simon, CBS News, Group 1.
In order to fully understand U.S. military involvement in Southeast Asia, it's imperative to examine the history of the region. The Vietnamese had struggled for their independence for 2,000 years before it was finally won in 1975. For 1,000 years, it was directly ruled and occupied by China, and even though it regained formal autonomy in 939 AD, it remained a tributary state to its Chinese neighbor to the north. In the 19th century, the Europeans came to Asia seeking empire. France conquered Vietnam and, along with Laos and Cambodia, called it French Indochina and made it one of their colonial possessions. For 100 years, the French exploited the people and resources of Vietnam for the benefit of France. Cheap labor and rubber were their chief bounties. When World War II started, the Nazis conquered France and Japan got Vietnam, although they retained the French administrators. Similarly, at the end of the war, after the Japanese were defeated, disarmed, and imprisoned by the British, they were released from custody and given back their weapons because the British and the French, having no substantial forces of their own at hand, needed the Japanese help in putting down the Vietnamese revolt. Governments that fought so bitterly over the division of the world showed a curious unity when it came to keeping the colonies dependent. President Eisenhower expressed what he felt the loss of Vietnam might mean.
If Indochina goes, several things happen right away. The Krai Peninsula, the last little bit of end hanging on down there, would be scarcely defensible. The tin and the tungsten that we so greatly value from that area would cease coming.
Resistance to the Japanese occupation was organized by a revolutionary national liberation movement formed by many nationalist leaders in 1941 and known as the Viet Minh. By the end of the war, a young French-educated communist by the name of Ho Chi Minh had emerged as the clear leader of the Viet Minh. Years before he became a communist, Ho Chi Minh lived in Harlem, New York, attended lectures of Marcus Garvey, and was greatly influenced by the struggle for liberation of black Americans. On September 2, 1945, Ho Chi Minh proclaimed the Democratic Republic of Vietnam, and he did so with words familiar to all Americans.
All men are created equal. They are endowed by the Creator with certain inalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
Astonishingly, the Republic of Vietnam declared its independence with words taken from our own. For our part, President Roosevelt declared against allowing the French to recolonize Vietnam. And initially, the French did recognize the young republic. But then Roosevelt died, and Truman took over. President Truman saw the situation differently. His focus was on the pending Cold War and the struggle against the Soviet Union. Now it was seen as important to rapidly rebuild France as a bulwark against the Soviets, and that meant helping France get her colonies back. Accordingly, and with U.S. backing...
Towards the end of November of 1946, when the admiral commanding the French fleet in the Bay of Tonkin, in his words, decided to teach the Vietnamese government a hard lesson, and the fleet stood off of Haiphong and shelled the city, until between 6,000 and 10,000 were killed.
Thus began the 10-year struggle that the Vietnamese remember as the French War. While the soldiers may have been French, or in many cases hired mercenaries in the French Foreign Legion, the funding was largely American. The French had just been rescued from one war and were in no position to finance another. As Lyndon Johnson said in 1964,
every day, someone jumps up and shouts and says, tell us what is happening in Vietnam and why are we in Vietnam and how did you get us into Vietnam? Well, I didn't get you into Vietnam. You've been in Vietnam 10 years.
The French began the war as a colonial war. They try many times to change this very nature of the war, trying to change it in a civil war, a war between the right and the left in Vietnam, and after that in international war, a crusade against communism.
As the French were decisively beaten at Dien Bien Phu in 1954, they made plans to leave Vietnam. It was the first time a European army had been defeated by an indigenous Southeast Asian resistance movement. At the Geneva Conference, Vietnam was divided at the 17th parallel, with the French and the puppet government it had set up in 1949 still in control of South Vietnam.
It might be really repeated here. There is no two Vietnams. There is only one Vietnam, temporarily divided in Geneva in 54 between a free zone with the North Vietnam and an occupied zone, occupied by the French, but then the French had still, after Geneva, the jurisdiction of over South Vietnam because they could not hand it over to a regime which did not exist. It's not even mentioned in the Geneva Agreement. The regime of Saigon is only a temporary one, in waiting for election.
According to the Geneva Accord, the division was to be temporary, with elections in 1956 to settle the matter of reunification. Those elections never took place.
The refusal was amply justified, if only because the kind of election envisaged by the Geneva Agreement of 1954, a free election, could not have been held. Anyone who thinks that a free election was possible in communist North Vietnam knows little of how communists operate and could have fallen into a Moscow Peking trap.
And you ought to have sat with me on the Foreign Relations Committee in 1956 when our intelligence forces brought in their reports warning that if the election called for by the Geneva Accords for July 1956 were held, Ho Chi Minh would be elected president in South Vietnam by at least 80% of the vote. And our country, that boasts about believing in self-determination, used its power and its prestige and its influence really to get our first puppet government under GM not to cooperate in holding those elections. That's just a matter of historic record.
In 1955, Bao Dai, the emperor the French had installed as the head of the state of Vietnam, was deposed, and a new leader, Ngo Diem Diem, was installed as the head of the renamed Republic of Vietnam. Diem was the U.S. man in Vietnam, and what had been the French War was quietly becoming the American War.
There was sort of a cult of the little fellow in the sharkskin suit and the little Mandarin who's going to stop the Reds. And there was a great many articles along this line, you know, sort of Ngo Dinh Diem, our man in Saigon.
Then, as now, the danger was greatly hyped to drive the country towards war.
If we lose Indochina, Mr. Jenkins, we will lose the Pacific, and we'll be an island in a communist sea.
A retreat of the from the United States from Vietnam would be a communist victory, a victory of massive proportions, and would lead to World War III.
And promises were made to puppets.
We'll save for as long as it takes. We shall provide whatever help is required to win the battle against the communist insurgents.
While both the Democrat and Republican administrations that preceded him had provided funding for the fight against Vietnamese independence, John Kennedy was the first president to send U.S. troops to Vietnam in significant numbers. He started by replacing the French berets with green berets and had sent more than 16,000 soldiers by the time he was assassinated.
People like the Kennedys were used to running countries with names they couldn't even pronounce.
Vietnam is now a free nation.
My fellow Americans, Laos is far away from America.
Earlier in 1963, the U.S. supported a coup in Iraq that put the Ba'ath Party in power. the CIA specifically supported a young 25-year-old Baathist by the name of Saddam Hussein, providing him with a list of his enemies, including 700 communists and Democrats to be eliminated. A bloodbath ensued.
At a White House meeting to plan the overthrow of Diem, less than a month before JFK himself is murdered, Bobby Kennedy worries that Vietnam might not be so easy and wonders about the wisdom of putting someone they hardly know in charge of such an important country.
We don't see the end of the tunnel, but I must say I don't think it's darker than it was a year ago, in some ways lighter.
In the course of my ambassadorship, which had been agreed to be last just 1 year, I dealt with five governments. In other words, the house was cleaned and turned over five different times with a chaos that one can imagine.
While the National Security Council was busy replacing Vietnamese government's right and extreme right, LBJ acted like he was the victim.
The thing that worried Johnson and constantly worried him was the instability of the South Vietnamese government. I guess you might call the coat of arms of the Vietnamese government was a turnstile, for God's sake. And I remember very vividly, somebody would come in his office and say, looks like there's a coup beginning in Vietnam again. Another coup, you know, coups were like fleas on a dog. And Johnson said, I don't want to hear any more about this coup shit. I've had enough of it. And we've got to find a way to stabilize those people out there.
But Johnson knew it was the CIA that was the source of the problems.
They started with me on Jim, you remember. Yeah. He was corrupt and he ought to be killed. So we killed him. We all got together and got a goddamn bunch of thugs and we went in and assassinated him. Now we really had no political stability since then.
But democracy via puppet governments had its own embarrassing moments.
They gave us a text in English. At that time, I thought, I'd say, if our opposition knew that at this moment we were discussing the fate of our country in a text in English, boy, you know, it would be so bad that we shouldn't even think about it. So I asked, I said, where's the Vietnamese text? Oh, we forgot. And I said, what do you mean you forgot? The other side, I know they don't present a text to you in English. You know, between Vietnamese, we know each other. You know, there's something called national pride. You present your own language. I said, oh, this is a good translation. We have our own translators. I don't know what is the name of the guy he gave. I say, you mean to tell me an American is, understand Vietnamese better than a Vietnamese?
There is a contradiction between the declaration of friendship and respect from Mr. Dean Rusk on one hand and on the other hand, your forces in South Vietnam continue to come into Cambodia and to kill peasants and innocent civilian servants.
Nixon expanded the war to Cambodia by overthrowing the legitimate government of Prince Sihanouk and setting up a puppet government there.
Some officers in our army and many deputies and many members of the government in Phnom Penh, they want to be your allies in order to have dollars, your dollars. They don't think about the destiny and the fate of our homeland. They don't mind about it. They are more patriots
for dollars than for Cambodia.
We've made a conscious decision not to send American troops in. There are no American combat troops in Cambodia. There are no American combat advisors in Cambodia. There will be no American combat troops or advisors in Cambodia. We will aid Cambodia. Cambodia is the Nixon Doctrine in its purest form. Vietnam was in violation of the Nixon Doctrine.
The Nixon Doctrine included secret bombings, the massacre of civilians, and paying children to fight.
What sort of gun is that that he's carrying?
Apache. M60. He said can do two things, automatically and semi-automatic.
How old is he?
10 years old.
The expansion of the war into Cambodia and the resulting rise to power of Pol Pot was to have tragic consequences for that little country. In addition to the estimated 800,000 civilians killed in Nixon's illegal bombing, another 2 million died after the war as the Khmer Rouge attempted to feed people the U.S. was no longer feeding by forcing millions that the U.S. had moved into the cities back into the countryside. LBJ wanted to expand the war, but the resolution he had put to Congress had been shelved for months.
What I want is somebody that can lay up some plans to trap these guys and whoop hell out of them, kill some of them. That's what I want to do.
I'll try and bring something back that will meet that objective.
Okay, Bob.
After what he called an unprovoked attack, he got his resolution.
Congressional leaders of both parties supported the Gulf of Tonkin resolution. In fact, only two members of Congress voted against the resolution, Senators Morse of Oregon and Greening of Alaska.
Being in the minority never proves that you're wrong. In fact, history is going to record that Senator Greening and I voted in the interest of the American people this morning when we voted against this resolution. And I'd have the American people remember what this resolution really is. It's a resolution which seeks to give the President of the United States the power to make war without a declaration of war.
The Gulf of Tonkin resolution was not a declaration of war. There never was a declaration of war in Vietnam, but it served much the same purpose. The President was given broad powers to wage war. But what the Congress did not know, what the country did not know, is that the second attack in the Gulf of Tonkin may never have happened.
It is now known beyond any reasonable doubt that an attack did not take place. Even the official U.S. Navy history states there was actually no North Vietnamese attack that night.
If one telegram, which we later found from Commander Herrick of the Maddox, had been made available to the committee at that time, I'm quite sure they would have had long hearings, gone into it thoroughly, and if they'd been able to discover the facts as they actually were, I don't believe it passed the resolution because it was based upon absolutely false, erroneous information. The events as they related them of August the 4th, 1964, were not true. Our ships were, it was not an unprovoked, deliberate attack. In fact, there was no attack at all.
Did the captains report what they were ordered to report?
It's also been suggested that Washington was putting a great deal of pressure on you to come up with some positive answers
to what happened that night. A positive answer being, yes, we were attacked.
Well, I'm sure they needed one, and that's what we were trying to obtain for them, and we did, and sent it in.
Did the gunner shell an empty gulf?
Just above the bridge of the Maddox, where Captain Herrick was, is the main gun director. And inside the director was the sailor who was in charge of firing those powerful 5-inch guns. His job was to open fire once the enemy targets were spotted on radar or sonar. Those are the main methods for detecting targets you can't see directly.
The man in charge of the Maine gun director, August 4th, 1964, was a four-year veteran. He was also an expert sonar man, Patrick Park. Park is now a businessman in Los Angeles.
Tell me, do you think that night, August 4th, in the pitch black, in a heavy swell, rainstorms, was there anything to shoot at out there?
No, I don't. I'm certain that there was not anything to shoot at right from the beginning. The captain asked me immediately after the attack to go down and evaluate all the recordings that had been made of noise that sonar was reporting. And I kept myself pretty busy for the next 3 days, really, trying to evaluate these things and determine if we had heard anything that might have been even a question mark, that it might have been a torpedo or anything else in the water not related to the two ships or noise of either one of them.
And what was your evaluation?
Absolutely nothing.
The pilots didn't see anything either. Before James Bond Stockdale became a North Vietnamese prisoner of war, he was flying air cover over the destroyers at the time of the alleged second attack.
In Stockdale's words, "I flew so low there was salt spray on my windshield, and I still didn't see a thing," meaning he never saw torpedoes or any evidence that the U.S. ships had been fired upon. The captain of the Ticonderoga's Attack Squadron 56, Commander Wesley L. McDonald, concurred he didn't see anything that night except the Maddox and the Turner Joy. After this flight, he and those in his command met behind closed doors, and each wrote accounts of what they did and did not see. Stockdale then locked these reports in his safe. The next morning, Commander James Stockdale was ordered to lead the first U.S. airstrike on North Vietnam.
I personally am convinced, in my own mind, that no attack took place on the 4th. But, of course, it's impossible, really, in a way, for me to prove a negative. I'll put it this way. They most certainly did not prove the affirmative case that there was an attack.
Since there was no second attack, and since that attack was the excuse that the president used to take the U.S. to war in Vietnam, what are we to make of the following recently released White House tape? In it, LBJ and McNamara discuss the second Gulf of Tonkin attack before it takes place. How would they know about the attack before it happened? And why would they want to keep that prior knowledge a secret, unless they were planning it?
Now, this is an action that we might well wish to consider after the second attack, but I think it would be inappropriate, General Wheeler agrees and Dean Rusk agrees, inappropriate to provide the task force commander that authority. There will be ample time for us after a second attack to bring this problem to your attention. You can then decide how far you wish to pursue the attacker into his base area.
But I wish we could have something that we've already picked out and just hit about three of them damn quick right after.
We will have that, and I talked to Mac Bundy a moment ago and told him that I thought that was the most important subject we should consider today, and be prepared to recommend to you a response, a retaliation move against North Vietnam in the event this attack takes place within the next 6 to 9 hours.
And we do that at lunch. There's some things I don't want to go in with these other. I want to keep this as close as I can, so let's just try to keep it to the two or three.
Be prepared to do so at lunch.
Nước quân Mỹ.
On the night of August 4th, the United States made public the so-called Gulf of Tonkin incident. But the story was a fabrication created by the U.S. National Security Council. Even as the National Security Council met, American aircraft were being sent to destroy several areas of our country. In reality, the second Gulf of Tonkin incident never happened.
Was the whole basis of this war a fraud and a lie perpetrated at the highest levels of our government? We must ask ourselves that as we survey the damage that was done to our country, and especially the damage done to the Vietnamese.
If this little nation goes down the drain and can't maintain her independence, ask yourself what's going to happen to all the other little nations.
If Kennedy thought he could finesse the Vietnam situation with special forces, Johnson's approach was brutally simple. He figured if he could kill enough of them, they would cry uncle. And the simplest way to kill them was with air power.
We're off to bombing these people. They're over that hurdle. The game now is that the fourth quarter and about 78-0.
The primary tool that the U.S. used in the Vietnam War was aerial bombardment. That is how the most people were killed, both North and South. The U.S. used napalm, they used cluster bombs, they used white phosphorus, they used chemical agents, but most of all, they used old-fashioned high-explosive bombs. And by the time it was all over, the U.S. government had dropped three times the amount of bombs dropped by all parties in World War II, more than 8 million tons, or the equivalent of 640 Hiroshima-sized atomic bombs.
What do you think about it? I don't see why we bring Goldwater in on this. Why don't we just say I thought it appropriate just to communicate my decision to the Republican candidate for president, not say he's assured me of his full support. I think it makes us sound like we're very much together and buddies and agreeing on bombing everybody. Buddy.
Power system that fuels every war-making facility. The transportation system, rails, rolling stock, bridges, yards, eliminated. Every factory and every industrial installation, beginning with the biggest and the best, and never ending so long as our two bricks still stuck together. And if necessary, the irrigation system on which food production largely depends. We must be willing to continue our bombing until we've destroyed every work of man in North Vietnam, and this is what it takes to win the war.
Congress gave us this authority in August 1964. To do whatever may be necessary. That's pretty far-reaching. That's the sky's the limit.
When the war actually touched my life, the bomb was dropping in my house. And everything we have, all the memory from my grandmother, my grandfather, everything go up to smoke and turn to ashes. I was confused. Why are they burning down my house, my neighbor house? It's very confused to me.
Mr. Rostow. I remember had a theory, they call it surgical bombing. I heard him elaborate on this on various occasions.
My first impression on observing the areas that had been bombed was a complete shock. I was extremely surprised at the area that we had actually hit, the fact that I could observe no military targets anywhere in the area.
The theory was that they were bombing only steel and concrete, that it was a surgical war, that they were, maintaining humanitarian standards. When I got over there, I found out that churches, schools, hospitals, houses, entire villages were being wiped out. people just discovered that the United States was fighting an entirely different kind of war than it claimed, and it was violating all of the international laws of war.
We always knew when they were about to drop their bombs. For example, in the morning, they usually arrived about 10 o'clock, just after breakfast. Then they took a break and went back to their bases for lunch. Then they came back to drop their bombs again at about 3 in the afternoon. Since this was the routine, we tailored our schedule accordingly. We began our surgery about 5 in the morning and took a break at 9 or 10.
And it's either them or us, the way I feel about it. If the war wasn't being fought here, it'd be fought somewhere else.
You really think the bombs then are keeping the communists away? It is that important?
Well, I can't say it's keeping them away. It's keeping them beat back to where they should be.
Do you think it's effective?
Of course it's effective. Or they wouldn't be doing it.
For nearly 10 years, the U.S. sprayed more than 19 million gallons of Agent Orange, which contains the lethal chemical dioxin, on Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, and Thailand. Not just jungles were sprayed. 3,181 villages and as many as 4 million people were also directly sprayed. This spraying continued long after Vietnamese and American doctors began reporting the destructive effects on humans, and for nearly 2 years after American scientists proved the Agent Orange connection to birth defects. And it wasn't just the infamous Agent Orange that was used. The Vietnamese were also subject to Agent White, Agent Purple, Agent Pink, Agent Blue, and Agent Green. A virtual rainbow of death was rained down on the Vietnamese. Rice was the specialty of Agent Blue because the sturdy Vietnamese rice proved resistant to many of the other herbicides. The purpose was to deny the Vietnamese food supply as well as the protection of the jungle cover from U.S. air assaults.
This poison was produced by many major American corporations, including Dow, Monsanto, and Uniroyal. During the war, there were many protests against its production in the U.S. I am today very proud to say I went to jail in 1970 for my part in a sit-in against Dow.
While hundreds of millions have been paid to the U.S. and other victims of Agent Orange by the U.S. government and the companies that made it, not one penny in compensation has been paid to the main victims of these war crimes, the Vietnamese. When Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld visited Vietnam in 2006, he again refused to consider the Vietnamese application for compensation, although he did demand that they do more to find the last 40-year-old remains of American MIAs. The Vietnamese still have more than 300,000 MIAs of their own, not to mention thousands of little victims of Agent Orange born since the war.
We're fighting a war over there with a commodity most precious to us and held far more cheaply by the enemy, the lives of men.
They accuse the Vietnamese of viewing life cheaply, yet it is they that see life as a commodity. And by seeing it as a commodity, a thing to be bought and sold, precious or not, it is they that stand condemned for cheapening life by their own words.
I don't think it's necessary to have an invasion of North Vietnam. And it would be just exactly what the enemy wants. He'd like us to put down 100,000 men in a field, and they put down 100,000. They're willing to lose half of theirs, and ours is a precious commodity. And I wouldn't trade one dead American for 50 dead Chinamen.
Chinamen? What does our conduct in the prosecution of this war say about how we value human life?
What we've done with these B-57s is just going to be Sunday school stuff compared to the Marines.
The official White House story did not betray what was being planned.
I do not know of any situation that concerns the president more or causes him deeper personal anguish than the loss of American lives in Vietnam.
General William Westmoreland was picked to run the war.
I can say categorically that never in the history of warfare, certainly never in the history of the use of American arms, have more attention been given to the avoidance of civilian casualties than we did in Vietnam.
General Westmoreland was sort of a by-the-book type of soldier. He was, in his personal characteristics, a proud man, one might say a vain man. His approach to fighting the war in Vietnam was essentially that if he killed enough of the enemy, the war would be won. And he killed an awful lot of them, but the war wasn't won.
From the top down, the orders came. Enemy body count became the most important statistic of the war, and search and destroy became the operational method for increasing it.
If a battalion commander or a company commander figures, you know, we're told that everybody's enemy, and we can get this big body count, which was the number one career enhancement statistic in Vietnam. For example, we get this report of a VCKIA, but we don't have any evidence that it was a VC. No weapon, no equipment, no nothing, you know, just a suspicious situation. If it's just counted, which it is counted, and condoned, then there are elements of people down at that level that would figure, hey, that's an easy way to get a body count.
Testimony at the Winter Soldier hearing in 1971 revealed some of the atrocities this policy led to.
You have some testimony here on the burning of villages, cutting off of ears, cutting off of heads, calling artillery on villages for games, women raped, napalm on villages. Could you go into just a few of these to let the people know how you treat the Vietnamese civilians?
The calling in of artillery for games, the way it was worked would be the mortar forward observers would call in, or we'd pick out certain houses in villages, friendly villages, and the mortar forward observers would call in mortars until they destroyed that house. And then the artillery forward observer would call in artillery until he destroyed another house. And whoever used the least amount of artillery, they won. And then when we got back, someone would have to buy someone else beers.
In this video, we use testimony from many sources to bring home the ground truths of the war in Vietnam. This is what it was like on the receiving end of an artillery game.
They directed artillery fire into the area where I lived. All the houses and trees were destroyed. They also directed rocket fire against the homes of the people in my neighborhood. The people here used kerosene and gasoline, and so their homes burst into flames when they were hit by the rockets. Old folks, children and pregnant women who could not flee were burned alive in their homes.
U.S. tax dollars went directly to increasing the body count of the Vietnamese, and ears became the currency of the kill.
This guy came, it's the most emaciated, scary-looking individual I think I've ever seen in my life. He was a mercenary, and they got paid by the ears that they produced, pairs of ears.
As a Navy SEAL PRU advisor makes clear, these rules were set from the top. PRU was the enforcement arm of the Phoenix Program. And the Phoenix Program was the CIA-organized program of assassination and terror in Vietnam. Among other things, Americans on these teams would often carry out operations while dressed to look like the Viet Cong.
If they brought back a gun, they got paid for it. If they brought back a prisoner, they got paid for it. If they didn't bring back the whole prisoner, they used to get paid for bringing back identifiable parts. Okay? I didn't set these rules up. These are the rules that they played by. When you try to change those rules, you meet resistance. I didn't want people bringing me back ears and me and having to pay them for it. I didn't want that. I want live people. Dead people don't talk.
Here's a story from a CIA agent in Vinh Long.
There were five of us sitting in there, and we had an old French villa we lived in, where these irregulars came in with the district village chief, just, you know, covered in blood. They'd obviously just been come back from a battle. They had five or six weapons, and they threw the weapons down. They were just disgusted with the whole situation. They were going to prove something. Came up, threw a bag on the table, and the bag had 11 ears in it. And he just looked at us and he said, "You don't need the 12th ear," and walked out.
Americans collected ears too.
And it got to be where it was like someone would say, "Okay, you know, you come stay on my farm and you can go hunting every day for free and I'll give you all the ammo you want. And you can hunt and there's no limit and you can go out together and just hunt, you know." And this it was like a hunting trip. And the more people we killed, the happier our officers were, you know. It got to be like a game, like the object was to see who could kill the most people. And the different ways you could prove how many people you killed would be like cutting off ears. Now, if you brought back someone's ears, you know, pretty likely you had to kill them to get them. And then people would, you know, whoever had the most ears, they would get the most beers, and you'd trade your ears for beers. And it got to be like a game.
The Winter Soldier hearings looked into the treatment of Vietnamese POWs.
This one might be apropos. Prisoners thrown from helicopters.
Yeah, I've seen that. I've never seen them thrown out of my airplane because it's behind me, but we had a couple of guys from Philadelphia in our squadron who used to blindfold the guys with safety wire and pull them real tight, so this copper wire is tearing into their eyes and nose, and bind the hands with safety wire. And used to have contests seeing how far they could throw the bound bodies out of the airplane. And, you know, throw one as far as you can and see if you can get the other one farther.
If you could approximate, how many instances have you come across this?
Of that? In the two-digit numbers, say. Somewhere between 15 and 50, probably.
Some of these people weren't necessarily either Cong or NVA. Some could be VCS.
You never know. Yeah. You never know. If they're alive, they're VCS automatically. If they're dead, then they're confirmed VC.
We ever issued orders on taking prisoners or disposing?
We were told, do not count prisoners when you're loading them on board the aircraft. Count them when you unload them. Which the naive young Brown Bar says, "Well, why, what difference does it make?" And the wizened old first lieutenant says, "Because the numbers may not jive."
As at Abu Ghraib, the American soldiers that took care of POWs in Vietnam liked to take pictures. So the Winter Soldier hearings involved a few slideshows.
Okay, there's an interrogation going on right here. It's a big production. These are all the Marines sitting around giving the various cheers. This man here is a warrant officer. This just shows a typical Vietnamese who's bound. These are National Field Police. This man came over and put a tin spoon, it's a Vietnamese spoon, and he put it in my fire, and he's burning the skin off of the back of the man's neck. And finally, the man, in fear of his life, admitted that at one time he had given tax to the VC. But you can't prove that. I heard earlier today that They used CS. Well, the Marines used a lot of CS. This particular man wouldn't come out of the hole, and they threw two CS grenades in. I personally escorted this man back to division, and he died. So if gas doesn't kill, I don't know what killed him.
Is there something that you really kind of want to say?
The first slide you're going to see shows a prisoner of war, and the way that they try to get him to talk is by making him stand in front of a pile of Viet Cong bodies that we had picked up. It's the same POW was forced to sit for probably from 6 to 8 hours by this pile of bodies in the hot sun. It's a shot of 5 or 6 GIs going through the bodies looking for souvenirs. In this picture, there's a lieutenant and a captain overlooking what's going on.
Officers were present at all times.
Yes, field grade officers were present. And the next slide is a slide of myself. I'm extremely shameful of it. I'm showing it in hopes that none of you people that have never been involved ever let this happen to you. Don't ever let your government do this to you.
Call my job. Tell my boss I won't be here.
The slaughter was organized from the top.
You can't defend a place like that by sitting on your ditty box. You got to get out and aggressively patrol. And that's what our people are doing. And the one thing I emphasized to them while I was out there was to find these Viet Cong and kill them.
One time I went there to the headquarters for some reason, and they had all these boards drawn up showing the kill ratios in each brigade. And it seemed to me like it was kind of like going out deer hunting or something like that, where you'd search for these people, but you weren't going to keep the territory anyway. You're just trying to find them and kill them. And it wasn't, we were kind of trading some of our lives for some of their lives.
Vietnam was the first big helicopter war, and that's how much of the killing was done.
I was a helicopter, a Cobra gunship pilot. I worked with another aircraft at all times in what is called a hunter-killer team. I was told by the other pilots in the unit how to tell a VC from a civilian. If they were running, they were VC. If they were standing there, they were well-disciplined VC, shoot them anyhow. They also told me that when we were flying over a village or near a village, if people started to leave the village, civilians, it was a good sign that there were VC in the area, that they were expecting a fight. While speaking with my hooch mate, she says, when American helicopters come through, people run. They think they're going to be killed. So you put these two things together and you see, you know, civilians are in kind of a bad spot.
The officers' club of a helicopter support company. Outside, the temperature is 95. Inside, it is air conditioned. The music is always stateside. After the nightly movie, the talk usually centers on the war, on the action hours earlier.
Good job. I saw you splatter one right in the back with a rocket.
Roger, got lucky again.
That was a lucky shot, Bert, really. Blew the other one about 10 feet. I got the other two with the machine guns. Yeah. It's very satisfying to know that sometimes you do kill people with these things.
Good morning, Vietnam!
In November of 68, in an area called the Wagon Wheel, which is northwest of Saigon, while on a routine search and destroy mission, gunships were to be providing security and cover for us in case we had any contact, were circling overhead. Well, no contact was made, and the gunships got bored. So they made a gun run on a hooch with miniguns and rockets. When they left the area, we found one dead baby, which was a young child. Very young, in its mother's arms. And we found a baby girl about 3 years old that were dead because these people were bored and they were just sick of flying around doing nothing. Then, as we when it was reported to battalion, the only reprimand was to put the two bodies on the body count board and just add them up with the rest of the dead people.
Some people fell in love with the technology of death.
The prisoners that we've captured or have been captured say that this is the most feared weapon outside the B-52s. That is because the amount of ammunition we carry, the various types of weapons, and the amount of time we can stay on station. At the present time, we have on this a 140-millimeter grenade launcher, two 20-millimeter cannons, five 50-caliber machine guns, and two rocket launcher pods consisting of 19 2.75 rockets. We usually carry inside two additional M60 machine guns and ammunition for them. And occasionally, the crew rat holes a few things that they don't tell us about until we're airborne. The one I fly is known as birth control.
As many U.S. soldiers in Vietnam were infantry, their main mission was search and destroy.
We were given orders whenever we moved into a village to reconnoiter by fire. This means to, whenever we step into a village, we're to fire upon houses, bushes, anything to our discretion that looked like there might be someone hiding behind or in or under. What we did was we'd carry our rifles about hip high and we'd line up on line and parallel out to the village and start walking, firing from the hip. Now, there were times when Vietnamese villages have man-made bomb shelters to protect themselves from air raids. Well, sometimes when we come to a village, a Vietnamese would run out of the bomb shelter, you know, for fear of being caught. So consequently, this surprise would startle any individual and they would automatically turn and fire, thereby uselessly killing civilians without giving them a chance.
After our house was bombed, we have to go to the town next to our town and we were hiding in the bomb shelter. And a lot of people was in the tunnel. Some people were wounded, some people were dying, and women, children, too many people in a small space, smelled really bad. And my cousin, he wanted to go get some water. He's 5 years old, and I'm 14. I told him, no, we can't go get water because it's not safe. He said he have to get some water or he gonna die. He really thirsty. He get to the top first, to the ground level, and I behind him. And he walk a little way and he trip over something. I don't see it clear. Make some noise. And then it's so fast. Gun was blasting. And all I see is blood in body part that all over the place. And I still can't say, how can you just see a little boy then just little piece jump all over the place? Is that true? Is that real? You have to experience it to know for yourself what it looked like. What it sound like, what it smell like. Then I looked the opposite direction where the gun come from, then it's American soldier. Was shooting at my cousin. And I remember the way he looked. And to this day, when I run across American man who was in Vietnam during the war, I look and see if I can find that eye again.
They give him an ambiguous order, like some to the extent of, all right, you're going into an area where there are known Viet Cong, so that when you get there, anything that moves, you're going to fire at, you know. So this is one of the mind-tacking things that he does to make you want to, you know, attack somebody, even though you know that you don't want to kill another Vietnamese because you feel that he might be, in fact, your brother.
Before he opposed the Iraq War in the U.S. Senate, Jim Webb was a combat Marine in Vietnam.
People would flash. You'd have really good people. I had one individual who was a terrific Marine who we were on this one operation, and his best friend was killed. And we made a sweep 2 days later through a village, and this guy killed a civilian sort of as payback. I mean, in his own mind, he was sort of justifying it.
But another time I had a friend of mine killed, and I was very upset. And I asked this Vietnamese for his ID card, and he said, "Cam Biak," and that means I don't understand in Vietnamese. And it just pissed me off, so I pulled out my knife and I killed him. And it didn't bother me at all. I just called in, I said, "One VC kill." And they said, "How do you know he's a VC?" And I said, "Because he's dead." And they laughed and said, "Okay," you know. And I'd come in and people would ask me what's going on out in the front, and I'd tell them. And they keep a chart for how many kills you have. And I'd come in, and they'd show me how many I have. And what it is, every time you kill someone, you have to report it.
In one village, we wounded women and kids going into the village. And when we got in there, this was in Tuiwa also, when we got in the village, me and another guy, we were treating two unconscious babies. Not babies, but like 5-6-year-old kids. And a woman lying in a hammock. And I told the lieutenant, these people have to be evacuated, because if they're not evacuated, this lady had shrapnel on her, and the kids had shrapnel on them, and they were unconscious. I said, if they're not evacuated, they're going to die. He said, "Well, forget it, Doc. We don't have time to stay here and wait." And we went up on the hill right above this same village, and we fired down on this village the next day while people were trying to bury their dead. We fired down on the village at the people while they were doing their burial ceremony, and they killed another VC. Not VC, but another person in the village. Also, we went down that same day to get some water, and there were two little boys playing on a dike, and one sergeant just took his M16 and shot one boy off the dike. The other boy tried to run, and he was almost out of sight. This other guy, Spec 4, he shot this other little boy off the dike, and the little boy was like lying on the ground kicking, so he shot him again to make sure he's dead.
During the evacuation of the villagers from Ben Suk, I was struck by a sense of resoluteness in the villagers. They understood what was happening. They understood that they couldn't really change the situation. They were going to be taken out of their homes. I'm sure that deep down inside they knew that that was the end of Ben Suk as a village, that we were going to destroy the village. They seem to accept it with a very special kind of strength. It was kind of sad in a way, because Ben Suk was a pretty village. It was a very old village. The people there seemed to enjoy a little better standard of living than people in many of the other villages. The villagers were taken out by boat, by helicopter, and by truck to relocation centers. Basically, once the people were taken out, the whole thing was just turned into a parking lot. At the same time, the villages themselves would be destroyed, Anything of material value would be eliminated. Mattresses would be slashed. Rice would either be taken out or poisoned or dumped in the river. Crops would be defoliated, and it made it much more difficult for the Liberation Front to continue.
Dan Rather reports on these atrocities.
Our troops continue burning every hut they find and all crops, convinced that practically every man, woman, and child in this section belongs to the Viet Cong.
How do you destroy this much rice?
Yeah, the demo man usually blows it up.
You're going to blow it up, are you?
If they can't get it out, they'll blow it up. It's unmilled rice.
The Americans came into my house with their interpreters and drove us out. They refused to let us take any belongings with us.
Many of the refugees created ended up in the squalor of Saigon, where Morley Safer opened the CBS News Bureau in 1965.
It first appeared that the Marines had been sniped at and that a few houses were made to pay. Shortly after, an officer told me he had orders to go in and level the string of hamlets that surrounds Kamni Village. And all around the common paddy field that feeds these hamlets, a ring of fire. 150 homes were leveled in retaliation for a burst of gunfire.
On the first operation that I was on in country, we went into a village called Five Fingers, and it was a typical cordon and search, which is you surround a village and then you sweep through it. And hopefully when you're sweeping, if anybody's running from you, they're gonna run into the, of course, the surrounding troops on the other side, and then they get wiped out. But we received fire as we walked into the village, and we took no casualties, but we did end up with a body count. No weapons were found, so apparently they were civilians. The next day, in the morning, should I say, they rounded up the entire village, all of them, and marched them out. You were all prisoners of war, all of them. Men, women, children, made no difference. We filled two deuce and a halves. They were just relocated, man, just moved away.
I've hardly ever heard the term Vietnamese. They were always gooks. There's no difference between a good one and a bad one, except the good one at the time is carrying no weapon, but he's still fair game. The games that some of the Marines in my outfit played, myself included, would be to find the older papasans with the long whiskers, and which I guess is a symbol of his identity in their culture, and they would just be cut. They would brutalize anybody who complained. We would move into a village and we would just sit down. We own the village while we're here. These people would do what we told them, or they wouldn't be allowed to stay in their own house, or they would be beaten inside the house. We were on our first operation, and it was an operation, so it just followed this procedure. They were used to it, and we were just shown how you destroy a village. And they just cried and carried on. We don't know what happened to them. That was the only village in the immediate vicinity, so we cleared the area more or less. Everything is set on fire. My squad leader personally ignited the first two hooches and then just told us to take care of the rest. When we went out, I would say 50% at least of the villages we passed through would be burned to the ground. There was no difference between the ones we burned and the ones we didn't burn. It's just that some we had time and we'd burn them.
Mike Wallace interviewed Alexander Haig years before he was part of the Nixon White House.
Each one of these $70,000 monsters can sweep 15 acres in a 10-hour day. In Lower Binswang alone, they've cleared 3,000 acres to help bring security to 20,000 people. Security, a vital beginning to pacification. But the dozers do more than just knock things down. They help to build, too. The man in charge of the operation is Lieutenant Colonel Alexander Haig of Arlington, Virginia.
This is land that was formerly non-productive and of no value at all to the people.
Because it was jungle.
That's correct.
I think every person that was in Vietnam was in the infantry used CS, which is a gas, chemicals, woolly peter, that's white phosphorus. And we used these sometimes to clear bunkers and other times to destroy a hooch before we'd go into a village or something. If we thought it might be VC infested or something like this, we'd send in woolly peter mortars, 60 millimeters, and this would burn up the hooches that explode, throwing white phosphorus on different hooches in the village, start the hooches burning, and also kill people. It's probably one of the worst sights I've ever seen is a person that's been burned by Willie Peter, because it doesn't stop. It just burns all completely through your body. The only way you can end this burning is to cut off the air. It's very difficult.
We came here today to begin an operation aimed at clearing this area and mopping up the hidden Viet Cong to bring security to all of you. We understand that among you there are some who have naively listened to the Viet Cong propaganda and have joined the rebels. Among them are some of your husbands, your brothers. So please advise them to come back. We are ready during this pacification program to admit them back to society and to assist them.
Nineteen women and children were rounded up as Viet Cong suspects. And the lieutenant that rounded them up called the captain on the radio, and he asked what should be done with them. The captain simply repeated the order that came down from the colonel that morning. The order that came down from the colonel that morning was to kill anything that moves, which you can take any way you want to take it. And when the captain told the lieutenant this, the lieutenant rang off. I got up and I started walking over to the captain, thinking that the lieutenant just might do it because I'd served in his platoon for a long time. As I started over there, the captain panicked. He thought the lieutenant might do it too. And this was a little more atrocious than the other executions that our company participated in, only because of the numbers. But the captain tried to call him up, tried to get him back on the horn, and he couldn't get a hold of him. As I was walking over to him, I turned and I looked in the area. I looked to where the VCS were, supposed VCS. And two men were leading a young girl, approximately 19 years old, very pretty, out of a hooch. She had no clothes on, so I assumed she had been raped, which was pretty SOP. And that's standard operating procedure for civilians. And she was thrown onto the pile of the 19 women and children, and five men around the circle opened up on full automatic with their M16s. And that was the end of that.
When they came to my house, there were 10 family members inside, including my 14-year-old son. 4 or 5 soldiers came right over. When they came in, I stood up and greeted them. They laughed when I did that. They seemed to hate us. They just turned around and threw a grenade into the house. 9 or 10 people were blown to pieces. I was the only one who was wounded and survived. My son and everyone else just fell dead. I was wounded and extremely frightened and crawled quickly into a corner of the house. Although the grenade had already exploded, the soldiers fired their guns at the people to make sure that nobody would survive.
On Operation Stone, we were sitting up on a railroad trestle, and then there was a river on each side, and there was another company behind each river. And, like, the people were running around inside, and we were just shooting them. And, like, the newspaper said, Operation Stone, like World War II movie, you know. And we just sat up there, and we wiped them out, women, children, everything. 291 of them.
Wherever the Americans went, they burned and destroyed and killed. I didn't see any guerrillas being killed, only villagers.
That's the village being burned. The people were in the village. They, you know, like they wanted time to get their goods out and shit. But we just burned down the village, and they had to leave their goods there or get burned.
You might be able to come up with that. I was trying to find somebody that knew something about a village wiped out in Quang Tri.
Right, I was there.
You got that?
Because that was, we went into the area, and it was to set the example to show that we weren't fucking around. So the first thing we do was burn down the village and kill everybody.
Brush is quickly cleared, stacked, soaked with gasoline.
The Americans shelled the village as they arrived. Then they burned down the houses, destroying everything. Nine members of my family were killed. I escaped, which is why I'm alive today. But my whole family was wiped out.
The military mission became to inflict casualties, and the primary reason for existence became to minimize your own casualties. And you're sort of walking that tightrope the whole time you were there.
After they killed the people, they burned down all the houses, so the survivors had no place to live. They burned everything. Even dead children were burned. So I could collect only this much of the remains of three children. It was only a handful of bones.
At this time, some of the Marines used cigarette lighters, and the hooches went up, grenades. Some flamethrowers were brought in, and that was one way to quiet the fire from the village.
I'll tell you a trick they pull. They'll take a company, and they'll pull them back into battalion. They'll keep them there for darn near a month with no contact whatsoever with enemy troops. All right. Then all of a sudden, hey, we found a Viet Cong regiment. We're getting ready to move out tomorrow morning. Stand by. Keys your mind. All of a sudden, you're getting a chance to get a piece of some action because you're tired of sitting around in mud holes, you know, doing nothing.
Okay, today's the day. It's the big one.
This is the one we've been waiting for. This is the one you've all been saying to yourself, what this company needs is a good fight. By the grace of God, we're going to get it. From there, we're going to S&D, search and destroy, the thing you guys like.
I have yet to have been on an operation where I haven't gone through a village. I have yet. And I have yet to have gone on an operation where, when I've gone through that village was still standing.
Wynn tells us that out of 107 villages in this area, 106 were burned to the ground, some of them many times over. This area was a free fire zone. Anything that moved could be shot.
There's a large river that is to the west of Saigon, runs roughly north and south. I can't remember the name of it at the moment. But beyond this river, there is absolutely nothing left. There were hundreds and hundreds of villages marked on the maps that I had with me. All kinds of names on the map. But you get over that area and there's nothing there at all. It's all been wiped out long ago.
Actually, it looks like this beach has just about everything. Is there anything that it lacks?
American girls! I'd say.
Well, there are girls down the other end of the beach, though.
They're off limits to me.
They're goofs.
Yeah.
You know, slant-eyed. They're no good. We saw a gook standing about 10 feet away, and we got him.
These people are aware of what American soldiers do to them, so naturally they try to hide the young girls. We found one hiding in a bomb shelter in the basement of her house. She was taken out, raped by six or seven people in front of her family, in front of most of the villagers. This wasn't just one instance, this is just the first one that I could remember, but I know of 10 or 15 of such instances at least.
Take it off floor.
Anything with slant eyes, anything was that was a gook, was a gook. They were not human beings.
And we were always told, as long as you don't make human contact with them, with the hands, you will always see them as the enemy. But once you touch him, you're going to find out he's got flesh and blood like you do.
It wasn't like they were humans. Like, we were, you know, we were conditioned to believe that, you know, this was for the good of the nation, the good of our country, and that anything we did was okay. And, like, when you shot someone, you didn't think you were shooting a human. They were a gook or a commie, and it was okay.
The Vietnamese were gooks. They were all... We didn't just call the VC or the NVA gooks. They were, all Vietnamese were gooks, and they were slant eyes, zips. They were Orientals, and they were inferior to us. So we were Americans. We were the civilized people, and, you know, we didn't give a shit about those people.
You really don't have no feelings about it, you know. If you see a dead gook, it don't mean anything, you know. The only time you really feel anything is when you see a GI messed up. Then it sort of hurts you, you know. But gooks don't bother you, none.
I saw one case where a woman was shot by a sniper, one of our snipers. And when we got up to her, she was asking for water. And the lieutenant said to kill her. So they ripped off her clothes, they stabbed her in both breasts, they spread her eagle and shoved an E-tool up her vagina in a trenching tool, and she was still asking for water. And then they took that out and they used a tree limb, and then she was shot.
I fired a burst of about five or six at her, and she hit the ground and rolled over, and I knew it was a girl then, and it just flashed through my mind all the complications I'd have going over there. She's still alive, so I just went ahead and killed her. We came across civilians, burn their house, take what you wanted out of it, you know, mess with their women, stuff like that. It was just a nasty way to treat the people.
Sau khi mà giết chết sạch rồi đó, người giết hết rồi có số là đi đốt nhà chẹt cây chẹt cối bò heo gì bán cháy hết.
In the wake of the Vietnam War, there was much talk in the halls of power about what they called the Vietnam Syndrome, and especially the need to overcome the Vietnam Syndrome. William Sapphire of the New York Times called that revulsion at the use of military power known as the Vietnam Syndrome a national affliction. Sadly, most Americans are not aware of how many Vietnamese were killed in the war. In surveys, many have put numbers at less than 100,000. The shameful facts are that between 3 and 5 million Vietnamese were killed in that war, and the vast majority of them were civilians. After the first Gulf War, George Bush Sr. announced that Vietnam Syndrome was buried in the desert sands of the Arabian Peninsula. To help us get over the Vietnam Syndrome, Presidents Reagan and Bush orchestrated a series of quick military victories against small countries in which thousands of civilians died in Grenada, Panama, Nicaragua, Guatemala, and El Salvador. In reality, the Vietnam Syndrome is a code for the need to induce a kind of national amnesia about the true history and facts of the Vietnam War. As we witness the debacle of the Iraq War has become, we can see that they have been largely successful. The world, and especially Iraq, are reaping the results. More than 4,000 Americans and more than 1 million Iraqis, most of them civilians, have been killed in another quagmire, started with lies and motivated by greed. How long will this war and the policy that created it continue? Those who refuse to remember their history are condemned to repeat it.
This war must end now. This policy must end for all times. We must not forget our history. We must learn from it and proceed.
You're gonna look up and find yourself gone. How would you feel if it was your brother over there, huh? How would you feel? Lord, then you're gonna ask the good Lord to forgive you. Please forgive me for my sin.
That old Beach Boys song, Bomberan. Bom, 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 bom. Anyway.